Good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
It is Good Shepherd Sunday. So, especially when we have in our readings and in our message, we'll reflect on God as our shepherd and the overseer of our souls. I don't know if any announcements. Anyone? Anything coming up? Anything to mention? We do have our Oasis ending up. In a couple weeks, I think it was 18th. And I would thank everybody. I mean, we've got three meets up throughout the remainder, so thanks for that. I think we have Friday Grind coming up this Friday. So if anybody wants to make some homemade treats, they really relish those. So if anybody wants to bake something up, it would be greatly appreciated. And I think that's it. Looking at April. Okay, I'm good. All right, so let's begin with our opening prayer.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Shall we pray? Dear Lord, we are so grateful for all that you provide each and every day. Bless this church, O Lord, we pray. Let us be safe both night and day. Lord, you placed us together as a community. So many voices in our world are screaming that the church is out of step, a relic, an irrelevant institution that has existed beyond its time. Nothing new there. Help us in your church today to be strong, unmovable in your word, and compassionate with others. Help us to be people who read and study your word, and stay with your message each and every day. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen.
Please stand as we sing, He Has Made Me Glad.
He leads us and restores our souls.
He walks beside us through the darkness.
and never abandons us, even in death.
He goes before us and prepares a table for us.
And we will dwell in his house forever.
Though our Lord goes before us, beside us, and behind us, we still find a way to run away from his good pasture. We devote ourselves to all sorts of destruction. Still, our good shepherd seeks us out and brings us back to safety. He invites us to confess our sins before his heavenly Father. Heavenly Father,
we have strayed from you. We have wounded you with our sin. We have wounded others with our sin. We have wounded ourselves with our sin. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us back to your good pasture. On account of Jesus, our good shepherd. Amen.
Though we have strayed, Jesus keeps searching for us. Though we have been lost in our priorities, Jesus is always and ever devoted to us. We see this most clearly as Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die and rise for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. We are forgiven. Our souls are restored in Christ.
You may be seated as we sing, "Just As I Am."
Apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our epistle reading is from 1 Peter chapter 2. This is a gracious thing when, mindful of God, one endures sorrows while suffering unjustly. For what credit is it if when you sin and are beaten for it, you endure? But if when you do good and suffer for it, you endure, this is a gracious thing in the sight of God. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example so that you might follow in his steps. He committed no sin, neither was deceit found in his mouth. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed, for you were straying like sheep, but have now returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise for the reading of the Word. Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 10th chapter.
Lord.
Jesus said, "Truly, truly, I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs in by any another way, that man is a thief and a robber. But he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the gatekeeper opens. The sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. A stranger they will not follow, but they will flee from him, for they do not know the voice of strangers." This figure of speech Jesus used with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So Jesus again said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, O Christ.
You may be seated as we say, "What a friend we have in Jesus."
Oh, what gives me often
Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father, and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Amen.
It's Good Shepherd Sunday. And it's the focus is, as it always should be, upon the Lord, who is our shepherd. The 23rd Psalm, which I just read, as well as our epistle lesson today, makes that abundantly clear. St. Peter writes, "For you were straying like sheep, but have now returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls." You know, we're reminded today that the Good Shepherd has gathered the sheep, those who hear his voice, into the flock of his church. And we continually rejoice in the fact that God has raised the shepherd who was slain to save, to rescue his sheep. We delight in the assurance that death has no dominion over him, nor over those who hear and trust in his voice. We have peace in knowing our risen Lord feeds, protects, and guards his sheep who are gathered in his name, and he leads them out of death into life eternal. Those are truths that we need to always keep in our hearts and in our heads, whether we find ourselves upon the highest mountaintop or as we descend into the darkest valleys of our life's journey, especially when death casts its shadow. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. I see many people shun the shepherd, though. They pay more heed to those thieves that are jumping over the fence, they're trying to find another way in, or they refuse to enter God's fold, or just wander from it because they reject the path on which he leads. They neither recognize nor seek comfort in his presence, his voice, his rod of protection, and his staff of correction. Now that is Holy Scripture. The law which corrects and the gospel which protects us all along the way. Those who do follow Jesus are comforted by them, hearing his voice and walk in obedience, attending him in his way step by step, continually, quite literally following in his footsteps. I'm always reminded of that picture of the dad that's going out to the wood pile to get wood in the middle of a snowstorm, and the small child that wants to help. Dad's out there breaking, you know, taking a step, making the big old steps in the snow, and the kids following and trying to get in those steps, jumping, you know, just not quite getting it. That is us in our life as we follow Christ. Trying to reach those footsteps in his stride and failing miserably, but we keep on trying, following him all the way to the cross. When Peter wrote his epistles, Christians, for doing what was right or following Jesus and his path, were being discriminated against. There were slanderous accusations that were being made against them. And There was hostility directed towards them from their neighbors, their fellow citizens, and more specifically, their relatives, colleagues, and acquaintances. It wasn't just insults or loss of public respect, but actual suffering for Jesus' name. Verbal, physical, mental, social, economic, and emotional. Being aimed at Jesus' followers as public officials and various authorities made moves against them. This was happening because they were following in Jesus' steps, doing good, suffering for righteousness' sake. For most of us, for much of our lives as Americans, while we could in a small way maybe contemplate such opposition as we read about it in the Bible or in our history books or in the news articles from around the world, I don't think we ever thought that we could or would experience real suffering for the name of Jesus because of our biblical faith. For doing good. For upholding biblical morality. For speaking truth. Not only is that a real possibility here and now, but a reality for many people. And potentially many, many more. Instead of a willingness to suffer for the truth, many who would know better or should know better compromise, seeking an alternative version of faith that conforms to opinions or to society. Well, such compromises are in contradictory teaching or practices make them more culturally palatable and bypass ridicule and suffering. It is but the robber or the thief stealing the sheep. Any message that precludes sin, repentance from it, or living in holiness is nothing more than the doctrine of devils. It's faith without the cross without Christ. There is no salvation apart from Jesus, and no fold other than his one true church. I do not know how far a sheep can wander or for being devoured by the enemy, or how long one can survive without being nourished by his word and sacraments, the green pastures that he leads his people to. I do know that Jesus will never leave or forsake them if they were ever his, and as long as they turn in true repentance before they die, he will reconcile them to himself. That is true for all people. No matter their sins or how far they wander, God is gracious and wants all people to come to the knowledge of the truth, to know him, to receive him, to be saved by him. The epistle lesson today, though, is directing us not so much toward the seeking of the lost sheep that may be wandering, but St. Peter aims to equip us to live a life staying and remaining upon the path. A life of faithful endurance as the chosen, called, elected, beloved children of God. And that does not come without some cost. If you go along with the world, then you make yourself enemies of God. If you follow Christ, you make yourself enemies of the world. Do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God's. James 4:4. Following Jesus, I mean, really following Jesus, walking in his footsteps, you are a target. And as such, you can most likely will suffer for his name's sake. You should not be surprised when it happens, but expect it and be prepared for it. And Scripture tells us it's a good thing to suffer as we follow our good shepherd in paths of righteousness. Yeah, a good thing to suffer. In God's eyes, the suffering is a grace. If you do good and suffer for it, you endure. This is a gracious thing in the sight of God. When the faithfulness of the believer causes them to be made a victim and to suffer on account of their confession and noble life, it is a gracious thing. For to this you have been called. God knows even if we do not the ultimate outcome of our afflictions. God is not unmindful of this unmerited suffering, and he will not let it be wasted in the lives of his children. Although its ultimate outcome is not yet clear in the midst of our trials or tribulations or the suffering that we endure, Peter is telling us that we have been called to it and points us to Christ and his suffering as our example to endure. Jesus is to be our example in all things. He is our model. Yet the most proper vision of Christ is as the crucified one. It is the suffering Jesus. St. Paul says, "For I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified." Our salvation and our new lives are united with him there through our baptisms. And in the words of Herman Sasse, to believe in the cross always means also to carry the cross. A yes to the cross of Christ is also a yes to carrying your cross. Christ's suffering for us always comes first because he has suffered for us. He becomes our example in the bearing of our own crosses. Luther reminds us that before Christ is an example, he is a gift. Only when Christ is grasped by faith as Savior can he then be taken as the example of a life lived. We're not justified by imitating Christ, but he is the pattern for the life of the Christian in the world. Peter then grounds our sufferings for doing good in the gracious activity of God that precedes all of our actions. Jesus' suffering exemplifies his perfect nature through obedient endurance. Reviled, he does not respond in kind, but receives the suffering without complaint, only opening his mouth to intercede for those who crucify him. Instead, he entrusts himself to the hands of the Father who will vindicate his innocence. He overcomes evil by good. Under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, St. Peter tells us that Jesus is the suffering servant of Isaiah 53. In Christ's wounds, there is healing for the wounded. In his death, there is life for the dead. It is the cross that we are able to bear by his cross, that we are able to bear our own crosses and endure the suffering in this life as we die to sin and live to righteousness. Grace, even as we suffer. Isn't that a wonderful thing? In the valley or in the mountaintop, in Christ Jesus, the shepherd and the overseer of our souls, we find goodness and mercy. We find pasture. We find protection in this life and to the next. In his most holy name. Amen. Would you rise with me as we confess our faith together in the words of the apostles? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated as we receive our offering. May the gifts that are given be used to bring more souls into your kingdom and to nurture us as your disciples. Bless the work of these offerings in your most holy name. Amen. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Loving Father, your Son is the great shepherd of the sheep who faithfully gathers his flock to himself in the pastures of the Church. Grant us steadfast faith to hear his voice and follow him, even through the valley of the shadow of death, that we may receive our portion of his abundant life. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Holy Father, by the work of your Spirit, through the means of grace, you daily add to the number of believers. Grant your people courageous hearts and bold tongues to proclaim your truth, trusting that you will gather more in keeping with your gracious will. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, you hold in your hands all the might of man, and you hold accountable those who would govern your people. Grant to us good government and leaders who will honor your purpose, protect your people, serve the cause of justice, and defend our liberty. Lord, in your mercy. Merciful Shepherd, your wounds are our healing, and your voice our certainty. Hear us on behalf of those who suffer in body or mind, who grieve, or to whom death draws near. We pray especially for Dale, Sue, Ron, Jean, Jan, Diane, Tiffany, Johnson, Kim, Jan, those traveling on the trip to the sea, and all those that we name in our hearts. Grant them healing according to your will, grace to sustain them in trouble, and the sure hope of everlasting life. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, in the wake of your Son's resurrection, your people devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, the breaking of bread and to the prayers. Unite your people in one true faith and grant penitent hearts to all who come to receive the sacrament this day. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, as you have put our sins to death in Christ's body on the tree, so bring life to our faith by his Spirit, that in your continual grace we may bring forth the fruit of holy lives. Lord, in your mercy. All these things, and whatever else you know that we need, grant us, Father, for the sake of him who died and rose again, and now lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
We continue with the service of the sacrament. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Give them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord our God, King of all creation. For you have had mercy on us and given your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. Grant us your Spirit, gracious Father, that we may give heed to the testament of your Son in true faith, and above all, firmly take to heart the words with which Christ gives to us his body and blood for our forgiveness. By your grace, lead us to remember and give thanks for the boundless love which he manifested to us when, by pouring out his precious blood, he saved us from your righteous wrath and from sin, death, and hell. Grant that we may receive the bread and wine that is his body and blood, as a gift, guarantee, and pledge of his salvation. Graciously receive our prayers. Deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way, also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Amen. Come, O Lord Jesus.
O Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, in giving us your body and blood to eat and to drink, you lead us to remember and confess your holy cross and passion, your blessed death, your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, your ascension into heaven, and your coming for the final judgment. So remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Continue with our distribution. Now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and keep you, one true faith in the everlasting. Welcome to the Lord's table. Now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and keep you in the one true faith and the life everlasting. Depart in peace. Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have led us to the green pastures and still waters of this meeting. And we pray that you would continue to lead us on the paths of righteousness, devoted wholly to you, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Please rise for our closing song soon and very soon.